I'm going to introduce our first speaker, Brigadier General retired Pete Palmer. He is going to speak today on his idea of getting to a good enough cognitive shoe size. Brigadier General Palmer is the director of the EDGE Innovation Network, which enables user-centric technology innovations to be rapidly developed at industry and academic expense and made available to warfighters and first responders in an expedited manner. Prior to, Brigadier General Palmer performed over 32 years of active service as a commissioned officer in the United States Army, retiring in 2008, and serving as the Director of Accelerated Capabilities Development for the Army Capabilities Integration Center, ARCIC, at Fort Monroe. He managed a broad capabilities development portfolio with responsibility for the development and integration of Department of Army future and current fight capabilities documents, as well as science and technology capability documents for the Army and joint and multinational forces. Brigadier General Palmer holds a Bachelor's of Science from the U.S. Military Academy and three master's degrees from Cal State Santa Barbara, the Command and General Staff College, and the School of Advanced Military Studies. Please give Brigadier General Palmer your attention and engage him in his ideas about the importance of considering the cognitive domain as we select, train, and equip our future soldiers.
Thank you. First of all, I'm not the smart mad scientist like most of you out here, but I know a lot of them. Okay, so I like to put together a lot of stuff. I want to go back because I'm the infantry guy here, so the one that needed colored slides. The real key was working for General Wallace and TRADOC here about 7 years ago, we started the concept of the human dimension. The concept was involved in reviewing it, but then General Wallace turned to me and said, okay, we have this concept document, you're in charge of capabilities development, translate bureaucracy, it's all bureaucracy stuff. But that included working with DARPA and the senior advisory group, which we ran, and all of the S&T side, now run by Mary Miller. Mary and I were running buddies back then. But the key was go develop this capability. What I really want is the ability, especially on the training side, to have a leader's commander's UCOF. And for those that don't know what a UCOF is, it's a unit of conduct fire trainer that allows you to get your team prepped up to go through gunnery. So basically you train them all up so before they shoot big expensive bullets, they've done it in the virtual domain. And what they do is they go through many repetitions and gates, so they all build the teaming effort and they go do it. The problem was, for the commanders, we didn't have anything like that. And how do I get the repetitions at a command level? Because everybody commands once at one level, okay, basically at that time frame. And the point was, how do they get the experience? How do we get them to decision making? Because, and it goes back to the fact that I've worked for General Wallace a couple of times. I was the Op 4 commander at NTC, so I literally got hundreds of battles, but the commanders I was fighting had two or three. The difference in the ability to decision make, and I would argue the cognitive dominance OODA loop, is the ability, because I'd had enough repetitions that it was intuitive to me while they were still doing a frontal lobe decision making process. So the key was how do we get the reps? How do we build up that knowledge? And as I will get into it, the only way I figured we could do that is we had to get into the neuroscience side. And that's nothing against the psychiatry side or that side of the fence, but that's observed behavior. What we wanted to understand is how do they really make decisions, which you needed to get into the neural networks. As we peeled this back, it became apparent to me that, first of all, he says, stop using those brain terms because nobody knows them. We got to do it in other terms. And I'm going, okay, so we've been trying to do that for like 8 years now. And I've finally given up as we've done. General Brown's got the big impetus to do the cognitive dominance. And to be honest, I'm seeing great movement. The Surgeon General's office, which will be here later, is making efforts there. So I finally gave up and said, we need a Brain 101 class because we've got to raise the level of the education of the Army leaders to the level that they are for the physical domain. Now, how many out here are physiologists? Okay. How many know where their bicep muscle is? How many know how to use the bicep muscle for your job? How many know how to improve your bicep muscle? And how many know that there's facilities to do that? Okay. Now, for the Army leadership, we're all big on decision making. You heard adaptive leader. I mean, we got volumes that will fill this room about leadership, decision making, because we're experts on decision making and leadership and all of those factors. So for those experts out here, how many know the role of the amygdala and the limbic system in decision making? How do I develop it? And what are the systems out there to help us do that? And I'll tell you what, most, except for the scientists out there and your company in particular, most don't have a clue. Now my question is for the professionals, why don't we know what is the most, one of the most important biological elements like the bicep for the physical domain to make decisions? And why don't we know that? And why, more importantly, why don't we have systems to improve it? So, by the way, that deals with the emotional network, and by that, it's kind of an important thing to control, especially with the PTSD, TBI, now that's injury stuff. I'm looking for differences in normal. And now being on the industry side, the other side is, I'm also the vice chair for the human NDIA Human Systems Division. So we talk about human-centered design, human systems engineering and stuff. Those are all key too, but I'm gonna talk about this because there's several factors here. There's the science involved, there's the bureaucracy involved, but there's also the standards and the fact that, since I didn't do it, okay, in my organization, none of the capabilities we're going to talk about are in the requirements documents. We like material solutions, we like bright, shiny objects, and that's what we spend our money on. So the key is I think we're disadvantaging our soldiers because we don't understand our soldiers, okay? And by the way, with the Op 4 here, I'd say this applies to other cultures too, but we'll get in, that's not the purpose here. So I'm going to run through this. I'm writing a paper because I was asked to write a paper for the International Human System Conference I'm speaking at, so I wrote an infantry kind of paper here. But I'll start out with this aspect, okay? And these are the discussion agendas I'm going to go through, but I want to start out just with, I'm going to use physical analogies to get this. When I bring a soldier into the Army, I measure his or her shoe size. Now, why we have different sizes for men and women, I don't know. But we bring in the shoe sizes, all right? And we measure. We understand that if they're a size 9, and I give them a size 15 or a size 2 shoe, and I send them on a road march, not only are they not going to do well, they're going to be strictly disadvantaged and potentially injured, okay? And we all know that. And on the industry side, I know if I build shoes, I don't care what technology, because technology doesn't make a difference if it doesn't fit right, okay? I know I have to build 15 different shoe sizes. We have the standards. We all know that. If I make shoe sizes, I'm going to make it whatever it is. The problem in the cognitive domain, I don't know what cognitive shoe size you are, okay? I have no, I can't, you know, we can measure the feet. I haven't measured how you think, how you feel. So the point is, those of us in industry, those of us in training, those of us in education, all generically teach to a 9, size 9 shoe size. Actually, probably 4. We minimize it. But the point is, we disadvantage disadvantage them. And what we need to get to is how to enhance their potential, not immediately put them in a box that disadvantages them because we've given them the wrong types of education, the wrong types of systems to use in that piece. So my argument here is we as Army in this case, but it's really DOD we're having the discussion, because the chief scientist for the Air Force is trying to establish a human readiness level along with a TRL level. So that if you build material things, what's the level as it relates to the human? But we still need standards on the industry side. What do you mean, what sizes? Okay? And what I got amazed at is I work with universities, neuropsychologists, cognitive psychologists, neuroscientists, is there's a lot out there. There's a lot out there we can use today. The problem I got, because I got involved with, on the medical side, working the PTSD and TBI, and I was helping the bureaucracy side while we're working the medical side, is the medical community is, and by the way, there's a great book by Mike Matthews that got written. He's working on the Chief of Staff of the Army Senior Study Group about enhancing human performance. He wrote a book, but basically captured the doctor's culture. The doctors, first of all, want something to be broke so they can fix it. Okay, my discussions with the docs is, I don't want it to break, okay? And the other part is, they want a 99% solution because I got all of the FDA rules, I got everything else, and we do no harm. So instead of doing no harm, they do nothing. So that's a, now for me, like in a tactical environment, no decision is a decision, and it isn't necessarily good. So my argument is we've got to get those kind of standards, we got to bring them to the forefront, and we owe it to our soldiers to be able to do that, because there are no standards out there to operate off of, at least in this domain. So we're talking about cognitive dominance, we're talking about all this stuff, and we got no standards to work from. But I guarantee there's already been tons of material walking about cognitive dominance, and we don't even understand how cognitive functions occur, okay? So that's part of my challenge. So I'm sniveling to the big army, but I also threw out a proposal here to get us started. That's why I say it's good enough. And remember, as an infantry guy, anything above zero is better, okay? And if I played baseball, 30%, I'd be in the Hall of Fame, okay? So I'm asking for 50%, you know? And so just give me good enough. And understand it may not be perfect, okay? Because really, science, there are a lot of studies that need to be improved. But it'll never happen if it just sits and percolates on the study side. Because first of all, TRADOC, there is no requirements to pull across any of these studies, all right? And if there's no requirements, it won't get happen. All right, that you got to understand the bureaucracies and how this happens. So, and the studies don't advance because they don't get the population pool they need to advance the studies. So let's just do something and we can learn from there. So here's what I'm going to focus, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the details of the processes here, but here's the current measure. There are challenges with the current measurement tools, okay, that are out there. First of all, current tools are almost all medical, and I'm trying to figure out what's wrong with you. And as I have the discussions with the professional group, I don't want what's wrong. I want to know the different levels of normal, okay? Just like the different, you know, if you got a club foot, you got a problem. If I have a size 5, I'm not sure that's a problem. I just have a size 5. I just want to know what size 5 is. So the key is we have that challenge, is the tools have not been geared from, let's call it, an operational perspective. It's geared to a medical perspective, and that's got to, by the way, you can use them, but that's one of the challenges. There's a huge male bias in all these tools, and for those that didn't know, women are neurally wired on norm differently from men, okay? They think different, all right? We ought to understand that. And what jumps out at me is, you know, I'm parroting all the real smart people here. But one of the major areas that women are different deal with geospatial management. By the way, these are all norms, so everybody normalizes, and it's never an exact piece there. But women, in general, navigate by checkpoints, okay? Men navigate Euclidean geometry north, south, east, west. How do you think the Army trains land navigation? Towards a men's bias. Guess who doesn't do well on land navigation in the Army? Women, okay? Now, is that because they can't land navigate, or that's because we put them into a size 15 when they're a size 4 and the construct is working against them? So I'm using that as a general, and by the way, it's really individually based, not women or men, but I use that because there's studies that say that. But the real key is we ought to know that if we're trainers, we ought to understand we have just biased the whole women population as they're going through the land nav course. And the technology we're giving them may not go to what the technology that would help them do their stuff. So I'm throwing this out. We need to get to a baseline on the individual. I don't care what sex or what they are. We need the individual differences so we fit the individual with the right kind of stuff that they need from a cognitive domain. I'm going to go through real quick and say, and I don't want to go through each one of these because this would take too long, but I just can't, you know, Army likes acronyms, so I came up with the acronym TFA. How does somebody think? How do they feel? And I added how do they act, because the think and feel gets to real biological components in the brain. The act one is something that's a little more intangible, but I really like the tool. And it really is effective for helping me as what I would say as a commander do something. But it gets to how your instincts are. How are you going to manage information? How do you react to information? So I thought the aspect of just because I'm thinking and feeling something, I also want to be a measure of how that generates an action. So that's why I added in there. To be honest, I could care less which tools we pick, what you call it. It doesn't matter. Just give me something because we got nothing right now. So here's the kinds of measurements, instruments. I just throw these out as things that we ought to measure. And I know in the human dimension, we separate the moral and ethics, but without confusing anybody, it all occurs in the brain, all right? So just understand, morals and ethics are not in your toes or your heart or anything else. It's in the brain, although you do have some neural play in your gut. But the point is, you need to understand where that's occurring because that's how you shape it. If you're going to go train those kind of systems, you got to understand the systems and the neural networks you're training to develop moral and ethical behavior. By the way, you can also measure that, okay? By the way, the extremes are called sociopaths. And the studies show that 20% of the population has sociopathic tendencies. Okay, we don't have any press in here, do we?
What's the difference between
fluid intelligence is the ability to adapt. Crystalline's a hard fact. You know, that's our math and data scientists. I mean, that's just a hard fact. There's the elements and stuff like that. Fluid intelligence gets into the adaptability, your ability to go through that piece. That also gets into the experience piece, okay? The key is I threw out things that there's tools that could be measured. I would argue there's things we should be measuring, but I don't know the right tools. There are plenty of smart people out here, especially in universities, all right? This isn't a ding on universities, but universities like to do study, okay? Not necessarily produce products. So one study leads to the next study as we move the decimal point, 0.001, to the next level of effectiveness. So that's great, we need it, but I also need something that we can use on the front lines for the kids going on patrol. So if that's helpful to you, I think grit and drive is a really key, because you may be very smart, but you don't tough it out when you need to tough it out, and that's something you ought to be measuring. And see, these are qualities we ought to be looking at assessing for, because yeah, they're ASVAB, which I don't particularly see as a huge measurement for us, might not be good, but they've got the ability. If they got the drive and are willing to work at it and go learn, I don't care what their math score is, I can teach them math, okay? They got to want to, though, and that's what I'm looking for more. So how do you think, okay? And again, there's a lot more behind this. This one is, sure. They need to hear for the audience online.
I'm sure you experience this as the Op 4 commander, but on the circadian rhythm, you know, in uniform, when you're in a field, it's kind of considered a sign of weakness to actually execute a sleep plan.
Oh, we got a terrible culture on that. By the way, as the Op 4 commander, we got all sleep, okay? And the other part was, I like to know commanders that like to, let's say, manage the battle. So I intentionally caused the events to keep them up all night, okay? I understand, we're playing in the cognitive dominance role. What I wanted was the other, because 10 minutes on that battlefield to get to a position of advantage could make the whole difference in the battle. So if I could delay the decision-making process of my opposing brigade commander because he decided he wanted to get up for every artillery strike, hey, that's his call, okay? The point is, you know, I was fighting the commander. I wasn't fighting their machines because our machines were worse. The point was, the commanders that make the decisions are the ones you're going to. See, that we have a horrible culture on that side, and the problem is it gets people killed because the guys and gals make bad decisions. If I could change anything, I'd change the sleep culture and figure out a system so we don't have to. By the way, it's a PCTP commander too, so almost every senior general you're knowing now today, I did in some warfighter before the war. So I've seen all the different leaderships. They all love to go sleep deprived. It's like a badge of honor, which is absolutely stupid. And for the SAMS grads up there, you know, you like to be sleep deprived while you're writing the plan that's going to change everything. So the we got to understand the human dimension is part of this process and what we need to change. So by the way, how many know their circadian rhythm? How many have been measured for their, how many don't know what a circadian rhythm is? Okay. The point is we oughta, because you oughta understand when your best cognitive performance side is, and I'm getting a little off track, but I love schools because we always teach on this schedule, but understand the kid that needs math and might be good at math, he or she's not a morning person, but we give them this hardest subject in the morning when they're least adaptive to learning, and instead, probably would do much better at 9 o'clock at night. The real question, I go to the academic environment, are we really about education and imparting knowledge, or are we about attaining a schedule, okay? And keeping your budget, Fran. We got to look at ourselves if we really want to improve and achieve what we're saying in terms of cognitive diamonds, because we minimize the potential of the individuals. And everything I'm doing here is about how do I maximize potential. This is not about discrimination, because we already discriminate. We just do it without science, okay? What we need to do is focus on maximizing potential, not minimizing the potential just because it's easier for us to do. And by the way, everything I'm talking here doesn't cost a lot. Two satellites would pay for all of this for everybody, okay? But the point is, we like bright and shining objects, and going back to bureaucracy, what congressman's going to support this, because it really doesn't increase a whole lot of jobs in any of their sectors? We got to understand the fight that's going to go to really cause this to happen. Next piece is, and I pulled on this one, and Dr. Davidson's book is, what I was looking for is a concise way to do it. Really, the big five traits, if you get into the world, that's how they classify the feeling side, okay? I liked his because the terms meant more to an infantry guy on how we could use it, all right? And I'm not going to go through all of them. But, you know, we talked earlier about going into these tribes and cultures, and you got to go do the negotiation. Wouldn't it be nice to have social intuition for that person that's going in there and know what their level is? Because if they got a low social intuition, all they're going to do is set off the guy's amygdala and turn them against you. So we ought to understand where we are on that, so I, as a leader, can put the right person against the right position and task, okay? And right now, I don't know any of this. I don't know any of this for any of my soldiers, okay? Now, to be honest, we do intuitively pick it up as we build the team, but I think many of us understand we throw teams together left and right now. We don't have time like we used to in the Cold War to go build that team relationship. So how do I go build the relation on the fly? I got to start with a baseline, okay? Next thing is, and this is the ACT one, and I met Kathy. How many know what the Wunderlich test is? Anybody? Okay. For those that don't, they're using it for the NFL to do it for testing cognitive strength. It was started in the 40s as a session tool for the Army for cognitive strength in the Army, and then went away. But the bottom line is, Kathy Colby was Dr. Wunderlich's daughter. So she grew up doing these kind of instruments. What I liked about this one is, it's a tool, okay? And by the way, I says, look, this is a great tool. By the way, there's hundreds of tools out there. Some are good, some aren't. All of them measure stuff. I'm not disavowing any other tool. I think we ought to research and see what tools are out there and give the leaders the tools they need. But we do need some tools to establish a baseline. I like this one because it deals with information. And this is for a commercial audience. It wasn't geared to the military, although we're trying to get it into it or expose it. But what I liked about it, and especially as a BCTP commander watching it, is this deals with his instincts or her instincts for dealing with information. Do I have to have lots of facts? Okay, do I have to follow processes? Can I make a decision lacking information, or do I struggle with it? And do I have to have hands-on, translate, micromanage? Okay, and understand what Kathy argues is, this is how they're hardwired to act, okay? And we can say you shouldn't do that, but they have a need to do that. Otherwise, essentially, if you make them work outside their, as she calls their MO, you're putting them, it's like fitting them into the wrong cognitive shoe size. You're putting them under stress when you don't need to. So I'll use my wife, okay? My wife is an accountant budget person, been there for DOD, and now she works for DHS. Bottom line is, she is a big fact finder. She's got to have lots of facts, she's got to have her process, and she does struggle with a quick decision. Okay. Now, I'm accommodating. I'm sort of in the middle, so that's what they call it, is accommodating. But I'm a quick start. I'm easy. I can make a decision quickly without necessarily having lots of facts, because, you know, my intel community never gave me what I really needed to do that. So the bottom line is, you make decisions when you make decisions, all right? But I was comfortable with it. I will tell you, having fought other commanders on NTC battlefields or BC, some commanders struggle making a decision and they expect all this data and everything else to give them the answer, and it may not be there, but you understand, they have to have it to be able to do that. And the key is, and then the hands-on piece, all right? My wife is not a quick start, so if I want to buy, this is how you maintain a relationship, is if I want to buy a new TV, which I could, I'll go do some research, but I'll go buy it today at Best Buy and whatever the Best Buy is that day. I tell her 6 months in advance, I let her do her research, I let her go to all the sites, and she, one of her degrees is in marketing, so she understands when the sales are. And then 6 months out, she's much more comfortable to buy the TV, and she usually saves me about $2,000. So, I mean, that's how you work as a team here. What I would propose is, if we understood how the staffs are, and we understand how they act, then it would be better to understand how to interact with them, especially when you're sleep deprived. Okay, because then I know how does Gary like, does he need process, does he need this? And he goes, no, he doesn't, so I'll just do that. One of the challenges we get is you really want to have a mix of these kind of flavors, okay? The only tool we have is Myers-Briggs, so for those of us that grew up, I used to teach it. That was probably not the best tool, okay? But it was the only one we had. This one, I think, is much better, but the point is I know what you want to do is have a mixed team so you mitigate risk. Because they're all going to come at it differently that you might have missed. What I will tell you, we did one study with one unit. You'll be amazed at the clones. People tend to pick people who like them. I'm not sure that's a good thing, okay? Because then we don't have any risk. And those in the staff and stuff that weren't of that MO were always under constant thing like they were fighting the commander on what to do. And really, it was just how they both approached the thing. So I overemphasize this one because this is not the neuroscience side, although I did encourage Kathy to go out and get QEEG studies, which she did do, and that was work. But to be honest, this is well in the good enough category. Give me something, and it had application. So I throw that out to you. By the way, I'm not trying to sell it. I'm just giving you examples, and I don't care. Get the smart. What we got to do, Gary, is get the smart guys in the room. I tried that before. I could never get a single answer. Just give me good enough for now, and we'll build from that. How do I use this? First of all, we need the baseline. We need the baseline to understand who Gary Phillips is. So I understand as a commander, I understand how to equip him, how to use him, I'm going to use another physical example. If I have a 5'5" person and a 6'6" person, and I have this task over here that requires a 6'6" person, I'm going to assign the 6'6" person to do the task. If I have 2 5'5" people and I have a 6'6" task, well, we can put them on their shoulders, but the other option is technology. I give them a ladder, and now they can do the 6'6" task, okay? And we understand that I don't give every soldier a ladder. I just give it to the ones that need it for that task. So instead of having a procurement process that buys ladders for everybody, okay, we just buy the ladders we need based on who needs that ladder, okay? Now, in the cognitive domain, we buy cognitive ladders for everybody. Like, that's going to solve it. And by the way, it disadvantages some, because if I'm 7'7", you gave me a ladder, now what the heck am I doing with it, okay? The point is, and the fact is, if I have a 5'5" guy, and I got a 6'6" task, but I don't know they're 5'5", and I assign them the task, and he fails, okay? Now I'm looking at that officer or soldier and saying, why did you fail? I gave you all the resources. You should have been able to do that. And the answer is you didn't, okay? And the sad part is if you knew he was 5'5", I could have given him a ladder so he really could have achieved the task. The problem is we're making decisions, we're assigning tasks, especially in the cognitive domain, that don't fit the user that we're applying to them. And it's not the user's fault, it's us as leaders for mismanagement of those resources. And oh, by the way, again, we like bright, shiny objects, so we're gonna buy tons of bright, shiny objects for people that don't need bright, shiny objects. So if we understood that, then we could potentially, by the way, there's not exact science, there is efficiency to occur on this, okay? So I throw that out. We gotta get a baseline for every soldier out there. Now, for the universities, I'd say you need a baseline for all the students, too, but that's a different issue. Training and education, same thing. We got on, everybody, I have the discussion of learning styles and millennials. To be honest, I don't, everybody's fascinated with the millennials. It all goes to the neural wiring, okay? You know, the kids get grown up, they get exposed to a different environment than we got grown up in. All right? So they use different tools, and they develop neural networks that use those tools. Okay? They're not different. I mean, they still learn the same way. All right? They just have different tools to learn with. So it's not really they're different. We just understand it's about building a neural network. Now, by the way, there's a good point. How many understand the development of, you know, we all understand the physical development because we can watch it. How many understand the neural development? Okay, and when the key phases are. Yeah, we got some people. We ought to understand that most of the neural development, at least for soldiers, occur before we get them. All right? If you want to really train language, okay, you need to get it between 2 and 12. We don't affect that unless we want to affect national policy. So if they don't have a natural chip or picked it up back then, we'd probably be wasting resources trying to go train them on language. I'd always argue we need to train culture because I can get you a translator that's good enough. Treating culture is much more important than language. But the point is, there is a key thing that occurs developmental-wise when we get them. It's called the frontal lobes, which gets to the critical decision-making process that regulates the limbic system, which is the emotional brain. They're fully born with the emotional brain, okay? Okay, so the point is they have neural spurts that occur that would be prime times to influence them. We don't get them then, okay? We get them when the frontal lobes aren't developed. And oh, by the way, the frontal lobes don't develop to as late as 30, depending on which study you read, okay? I took the extreme side. So that means our squad leaders, team leaders, company commanders, platoon leaders, all may not have the neural connections to make a critical decision, okay? So it would be nice to know if they did. And by the way, you can test development of the frontal lobes on where they are. Now, you can get real exact if you want to stick them in fMRIs and stuff. I'm not arguing for that. But there's other tools. But I would like to know if the platoon leader has frontal lobes not developed. What really is probably a success for the military is we're very good at training. So that what we train them on, they have actually grown the neural networks to cause that to happen. And therefore, they can make decisions on the environments that we train them on. Okay. The environments we don't train them on, they get stupid, like going downtown and getting in trouble, okay? Because we don't train the social environments to the same degree we train the military tasks. So we ought to understand where they are in the development process, what training we have to do to be successful, and that's part of the challenge as we go through that. So that's something I think we got to understand how these kids really work. If we really want to train them, educate them, and make them better, we need to understand how the neural networks are built. But speaking of which, anybody know how long it takes to actually grow a neural network on average? And really, it gets accomplished and changes behavior to cause a neural, by the way, neurochemicals we ought to get into, but I won't do that here. But about 6 weeks is the average in the studies that we've seen. Repetitive behavior, okay, to cause that neural network. Now, by the way, if you throw in a strong emotion, it can grow quicker. There's lots of variables in this. But just understand, the end state of all our training and education and everything is a growth in the neural network, which, oh, by the way, improves resilience, too, for stress and different cultures. So think of it as a communication pipeline. And I'm a network company, so the size of the pipeline, if it's a big size pipeline, first of all, the information moves faster, and second of all, it's more resilient when attacked. If it's a small pipeline, doesn't move as fast, and it's not as resilient when they're faced with a stress situation. So what are the critical neural networks that we ought to be improving? Now that gets to like working memory networks and so on. We ought to understand what networks are important to our profession so that we make sure those networks are strong. Okay, and I'd argue, Gary, for your sake, when we go into these tribal negotiations, all right, you know, just walking in with flowers and thinking a one-time engagement is going to cause oxytocin to flow. Everybody know what oxytocin is? The trust drug, okay? Women, you know, use that in their breast milk to, you know, chemically induce likes from their children. That's how it happens. So, we ought to know that. So, the point is, how do I generate oxytocin? If I'm trying to build trust, which, by the way, wasn't in the paper at all, if I really want to build trust, what I need to know is what is the oxytocin triggers for that individual, that culture. So what I'd ask Gary to do is, for this culture, what triggers oxytocin? What triggers testosterone? What triggers, you see where I'm going, guys? We ought to know those triggers so I can give that squad leader, the squad leader, I'm not talking the general, I'm talking the squad leader going in to negotiate for the tribal well drilling, what do I do over a long period to generate, you know, 6 weeks of oxytocin, so now when I go into the tribe, he just naturally trusts me. That's how we need to attack it, I think, is to get to this, not the, you know, squishy way that I'm seeing, because there is a science, we ought to understand it. I don't need to make them neuroscientists, but they got to understand the bicep muscle is important, okay, and the neurochemicals that do that. Industry, I argue you got to have KSAs and KPPs, okay? For those that don't know TRADOCian or capabilities development, those are the requirements in the documents that tell us this stuff. It tells me I need 15 shoe sizes. Industry production range, you tell me I need 15 shoe sizes, then I know to build 15 shoe sizes. Right now, I don't know. I give you a good example, because our company's doing it and others are doing D6, okay? What's the range? I mean, everybody's talking about data overload and stuff. What's the sizes that I need to do to digest D6? And who's going to operate it? Because it's going to be different kids. And they're going to have different information needs. And they're going to have it, you know, and it depends on their frontal lobes develop. What's their experiential templates? What do we got to do? Well, I'd like to know what the baseline is. And then potentially industry can gear the system to gear to the individual that's using it. Okay? Now, that's a higher level math equation I just gave you. But we're struggling in the big data piece. Okay? And I'll just basically tell you, and I'll use General Wallace's example. If you have a lot of experience, I call it experiential templates, because what you want to do to get, as I would argue, if you want to get the cognitive dominance, what you want to do is get to instinctive decision-making, not frontal lobe decision-making. And to get to instinctive decision-making, you've got to build the neural networks for those kind of environments that you're going to look at so that my brain automatically goes to that loan and makes a decision. As an Op 4 commander, I used to call it smelling the battlefield, didn't know neuroscience there, but I just knew I couldn't articulate it, but you just knew. The brain operates a heck of a lot faster when you're in the instinctive mode than it does when it's in the frontal lobe mode. So why not get it? And by the way, you're also wasting power. I mean, literally wasting power when you're in the frontal mode. So the energy draws on you. Get them to the instinctive mode so they can make quick decisions. And the way you achieve my definition of achieving cognitive dominance is you get into the instinctive decision OODA loop. I can turn faster because the opposing commander I'm fighting is in a frontal lobe mode trying to figure it out, and I'm already turning, okay? So that's what our goal ought to be, is build those cognitive templates so every commander's in an instinctive decision-making mode, not in a frontal lobe. Now, by the way, you're going to be in a frontal lobe in many cases, but the point is let's keep it as often as possible. Aid tools. There are plenty of aid tools out there that could be applied today. And I, you know, Dr. Amy Cruz was one of my early mentors. She's a neuroscientist out of, I'm just using an example, but there's plenty of people out there. She worked at DARPA, so she understands the neuroscience side. She understands how it applies to DOD kind of bureaucracies, and she understands how to build these tools for training and education. QEEG is the more simple term. We could use that operationally today. And I'll give you an example that was a study done 8 years ago with the Marines. Weapons qualification, and I got to end here. Five?
5 to 10.
All right, let me just, weapons qualifications. On norm, you know, you got this group that does real well and you got this group that fails. So DARPA took this group down, advanced brain monitoring with their equipment and physiological, neurological sensors. And they baselined expert shooters that basically tells you what your alpha theta waves are and what your brain sight picture is, not what your visual sight picture is. So is the brain in the zone, okay? So they baselined, established the baseline, then they took a whole bunch of recruits and trained them using that protocol and said, you're in the zone now, now's when you take the shot. That study was able to move the qualification 2 standard deviations to the right, so everybody qualified higher. Everybody qualified less time on the range and less bullets, okay? So now, of course, hey, I got economic savings, I got improved performance. DARPA goes, Marines, do you want to accept this protocol for your training? And they go, no, we already know how to train, okay? We got a cultural bias here too, all right? The NCOs, no, we know how to do weapons qualification. We don't need all that tech stuff, okay? So that's something else we'll face. But just understand, We could have substantially improved time, save resources, but we didn't want to go that way. We also don't have the baseline on the kids. We got to get the baselines. We got to get the tools to fit the individuals. If you need a GPS, give them a GPS, okay? If they don't need a GPS, you know, land nav, we can spend how many hours and days teaching compass and stuff. Give them a GPS and they can move on, or a GPS that's geared to your cognitive preference. Leader tools and processes for operational readiness. We're going through, and I'll make the argument, you know, TRADOC's going through, well, we need somebody that focuses on human dimension. We got to have somebody that focuses on the human. We've got to get this up. And I'm going, look, we have the systems and processes already, all right? It's called for a tank, okay? My tank, before I go into combat, I want to know its operational readiness, okay? And before that, you know, we've got all our maintenance checks, our quarterly services, our annual services. We got a whole manuals that do that. We got a whole process. If it's not done at the operational level, we send it to the higher level. We got zero for the human. Before a human goes on patrol, they walk up, they're not in a body cast, they're going on patrol. And they're going to go on patrol in their position, doing their duty, regardless of what their cognitive strengths are at that point in time. My argument is, why don't I know the operational readiness of the most important system I have for the battlefield? And I know zero right now. So, first of all, you got to have a baseline before you can ever start. Second of all, I need the systems and processes. I need a dash 10 on every soldier so I know what their operational parameters are, because I didn't engineer Gary. I engineered the tank. I didn't engineer Gary. So I need to know how Gary's engineered, and I need to know, is Gary above baseline? We don't need to know, you know, is his toenails grown longer, okay? What we need to know is he above baseline, below baseline, and how much? And then I ask the question, why? Were you in a blast yesterday? Did you not get sleep? Did you get a bad letter from home? You know, I'm not the doc. I'm not trying to give a doc's tool. I'm trying to give an operator's tool. I need to know, are they ready to go on patrol? And if this kid is cognitively well below the baseline, I probably won't put him on point that day, because I'm not going to get that instinctive, intuitive decision-making I need when I go on patrol. Now, I'll still make the decision whether they go or not, just like I make a decision whether I send a tank out and its main gun doesn't work, because I need the armor. I mean, it's still a commander's. But right now, I have zero tools to do that. I have zero processes to do that. They show up and they go. And to be honest, I'd argue with the PTSD, TBI, depression, and all that stuff, we're putting the kids in situations we shouldn't be putting them in, but we just don't know any better. So, and I use another example, cold weather injuries. We've all been trained and given tools for cold weather injuries. We know there are certain races, if you had previous cold weather injuries, you're more susceptible. So the key is, and then I've got tools to deal with it, and I know if they do that, then I pay attention and send them up. I got nothing again for the cognitive domain for our piece. So I'll end there if we got any questions. Yes, sir.
Sir, I'll go ahead and start, and then
okay.
With the one online, and then move to the audience. So this is a question from Dr. Vitale. How do we incorporate technologies like advanced robotics and autonomous artificial intelligence into cognitive leadership abilities? And then he kind of tries to clarify. That is, can we have space in the fight for artificial intelligence?
Oh, absolutely. But see, I would argue that we've got to know what the baseline is so I know what I'm augmenting, okay? Where do I need augmentation? Now, if he's talking artificial intelligence from a robotics piece and machine interface, probably not this subject discussion, but AI is, if somebody's got a good AI tool, I'll take it every day. Come show me. But an AI tool, it's got to be related to the function you're trying to do. Are we done? I'm sorry, did I go over? Any other questions?
Sean Walsh from the Army Research Lab. It's related to actually the last question, but there's a lot of talk about soldier-robot teaming. Mm-hmm. And based on some of your ideas here, do you think there's some people that either psychologically or cognitively are going to be more inclined to accept the idea of teaming with an inanimate or artificial object than others?
Oh, I think so. Everybody likes to play with the toys. To really answer your question, because what we want to get to is away from the one-on-ones, we want to get to the many. What we need is a trainer to deal with many, okay? And it's an attention piece. By the way, I need an AI piece to help with that so I don't have to watch everything. But I've got another company that deals with sports training and everything else that manages attention. And the point is can I manage two objects? Can I manage three objects? Can I manage four objects? And pretty much after four that are moving in space, it gets tough to do. What you got to do is build the neural networks to be able to manage all those, and they grow the intuitive decision making, because initially they're going to start out with a frontal lobe, and I need to get them to its instinctive, because instinctive, they're not going to be thinking about it, they just recognize it. That makes sense? I don't know who's next. Yeah.
Piotr Franaszczuk from ARL HRED. Actually, exactly, the one question is about what you mentioned. You are stressing that you want every decision-making to be instinctive. But actually, we are talking about the adaptive leadership and flexible leadership, and actually, we would like them to adapt and change their behavior and not doing everything instinctively. So maybe that's a little, so maybe we should concentrate on creating a good networks, plasticity of networks in frontal lobe, so they actually can adapt better instead of moving everything to instinctive.
By the way, I understand what you're saying, and do you work for Beth, is that?
No, I actually work for myself, but.
Okay, anyway, first of all, there's lots of definitions of adaptive. And I would tell you that some of the measurement tools, and Colby would go, is, okay, if you're not a quick start, you're not real adaptive, okay? Because you're hardwired not to be adaptive because you need all these processes. It's how you define adaptive and how quickly do I have to be adaptive, okay? But to get to your answer is, I would argue that if I have, let's just say as an Op 4 commander, I got 500 battles under my belt, okay? I've seen all the different scenarios for this environment. My adaptability is based on the ability to quickly recognize which template's important. The challenge gets to is when you're faced with a novice situation, all right, that we haven't trained them on, then I think it goes to how you're hardwired for adaptability. Am I able to deal with the situation and be comfortable? That's one of the reasons I like the Colby, is because if I'm a quick start, I can adapt even if I don't have the experience, because my MO is I'm okay making a quick decision. Still, by the way, it doesn't mean it's right. It just means I'm okay making that decision. Obviously, system large group and team adaptability. Adaptability on a team would be geared to the fact I've got a mixed team because they all come with different MOs and different profiles, so I've minimized my risk. And adaptability in my team is I know Smith, who's the squad leader, really would be, in this environment, would be better being the point man just given where they are cognitively. So, but to get to the adaptability, and I'm not sure I'm right in all this, because my problem is we in the DOD argue terms and definitions till we're blue in the face, okay? You ought to see what it took just to get the three terms we did for human dimension through the group. But the point is, adaptability means lots of things to different people. What I'm trying to bracket back into is if you got a robust neural network with a broad experience, you're much more adaptable, but you still got to understand baseline. Some people just aren't flat adaptable. Or the what we're saying adaptable is the quick stuff. I would argue somebody that's very deliberate, very process-oriented, can still be very adaptable and might give us a much better solution. They're just not going to do it tomorrow. So the question is what's the time frame on adaptability as well? So I think that's where we've got to have this discussion, but we got to get a baseline of what our force is that we're talking about. Because we're talking holistically, we're going to make everybody adaptable. Well, I'm not sure what that means because you don't know what you're starting with. I know how to make a tank better. I don't know how to make all these people because I don't know where they're starting from. We'll waste a lot of money doing it, though. Go ahead.
A couple of related questions. One is neuroeconomics.
Mm-hmm.
And how does that factor into decision-making under uncertainty? And have you looked into the measurement tools for that kind of leaderships?
Yeah, and it's at least, again, not the expert, but everything I see, it goes to the emotional brain versus the rational brain.
Right.
Or the stock market, you could predict it. Let me put it that way.
Neuroeconomists try to do that by measuring the chemicals.
Yeah. No, I see. I think all of this applies. And again, not the expert. I'm just throwing this out. What I need is experts like you that know that.
I'm not an expert, but I've studied. Yeah. Yes.
My point is let's get the smart people in the room, okay? and don't let them out for even a bathroom break until they come up with an answer, okay? Because if you let all the smart people in a room, you'll be there debating, you know, which level of adaptability we're talking at, but which we really probably need that discussion. But the point is that there's good enough science out there. I'm just an operator and nobody's given me anything, okay?
So there's a related question on cognitive biases. You mentioned, but have we found a way to measure those things?
Oh, I think so. Okay. I mean, you're going to be biased by your experiences.
But some people do more than the other, and can we find the right shoe, basically?
Yeah. Okay. Well, we all understand we got biases. I have biases based on my experiences, okay? You know, it's let's say the Air Force and Army have biases on how we fight. You know, at 10,000 feet, the world's flat. Okay, as an infantry guy, it's not, okay? But battle command and mission command are all defined the same, but it's not. So I would argue we can call them biases. It's really what is your baseline of experiences. So if I understand your baseline experiences, I'd understand where you're coming from. And if anybody's read Gates's book about the problem with the distrust from the Obama White House staff and the military, understand, we talk cultures. The White House staff are all politicians grown up with politicians, and so any action is predicated on some political move. The military culture is selfless service. We're going to tell you what it is, and we have no hidden agenda, okay, per se, okay? So when we do stuff and they get stupid and announce something in the paper they shouldn't have announced, the other culture is going to view that as somebody's trying to maneuver a political agenda. When we may or may not. The key is we didn't understand each other. We just assumed that they knew who we were and we knew who they were, and we don't. And it causes problems we don't need to have.
I'm Fran Zenzen from Arizona State University. Pete knows I'm an ass because I'm yeah, on it. So
beat me up.
A couple of things. First, we are starting to measure student proficiencies and how well they're going to do and try and get them out of there in 4 and 5 years. However, one of the things that comes about when you collect that data is you have now tagged somebody with some set of attributes. So my question for Pete always is, ethically, if someone to be successful wants to be president, but their test scores show they have to do something else, how do we deal with that? And the second thing is, how do we protect the privacy of that data, the ethical issues that come with slotting someone in a category?
Okay, well, I'm going to give you my biases here. I would argue we already discriminate, but again, we don't do it without data. And two, somehow when we go, I mean, in the physical domain, we have tall people, we have short people, we have fat people, we have thin people, we have whatever, okay? And oh, by the way, we discriminate accordingly for jobs and professions like that, okay? For example, you can't get into West Point if you're over 6'8 without an exception, all right? Does that mean they won't make a good soldier? That's a height discrimination that goes into West Point, all right? Now, why do you do that? You know, it doesn't help our basketball team. But the point is, we already discriminate from the physical domain, and everybody's okay with that. All right, but when you touch the head, it's like, ooh, don't go there. Well, the point is that, you know, it's the nature nurture. Not everybody is 7 foot tall in the cognitive domain. First point is, I think every individual in here ought to know where they are so they can make decisions on what they want to do and what they not want to do. As an organization that has to train and provide resources, I need to know the abilities of, I don't need to send everybody to language school because their language chip is not going to happen, and I'm going to waste a ton of resources on this person. Now, that does not mean, given the plasticity of the brain, that they can't do it. It's just the resource requirement to do that, okay? The other aspect is we're in tough operational environments. I need to know the operational capability of the kid I'm about to send on the front line, because that, it's not just about that kid, it's about the mission and it's about all the soldiers around them. And if I send somebody out there that's not operationally effective, it's going to cause us to fail. Now, do I need to protect them? You know, I'd love for a counseling to say, here's your baseline. What we got to do is really, and by the way, ethics change, and ethics are defined by culture. I always love, you know, we need to do our ethics. Well, whose? Okay? There is no national ethics. There's national, there's no world ethics. So the point is, we just understand ethics are shaped by culture and how they're brought up. You know, it will change over time once we get it adapted, but we got to get the science. It's going to be long term. Is there the potential of people being, I'll call it, discriminated against? Ideally, yes, but again, I say we're already doing that. All right, we don't let them in unless they pass the ASVAB. I'm not sure that's the good measure. I'd much rather have a kid with drive than the passing the ASVAB. So we can expand the pool we recruit from versus minimizing it. So the answer is, I mean, the neuroethics, I'll call it, we got to be sensitive to it because there's a whole crew out there. It's just like the robotics efforts that people, the unmanned systems piece that everybody fights. It's just something we're going to have to work through and develop. But understand, we're minimizing potential at the risk of something might happen versus giving the ability to maximize an individual's attention. It's the perspective I come from. I'm glass half full. Okay, half empty might see the other way.
Yes, sir. Bushnell, NASA. The mad scientist aspect of what you're talking about includes humans becoming cyborgs, including brain chips. We put 10,000 brain chips in and they're getting much better, and exoskeletons. Nutraceuticals, pharmaceuticals need to interact with increasingly autonomous, intelligent, capable robotics. And people are doing really serious research now for years on controlling thought and reading minds.
Okay. First of all, you know, I'm not arguing to it. We put a chip in every kid's head. But you know, if I have Parkinson's, that might be a good thing. So for the medical treatment piece, so I wouldn't throw out the technology because it can actually give people better quality of life. I'm arguing for basically hard training and stuff. Now, how many know about non-invasive brain stimulation? Okay. Might be a good way to accelerate training. All right? Understand, when these kids go into school, when especially universities, we're neurally wiring these kids. We just don't know how. Because we don't know where they start, we don't know where they end up, but we're neurally wiring. You're shaping the neural wiring of these kids and ourselves as part of this process. Good thing is you can change this throughout lifetime. The point is there better ways to do it? And again, we get into the neuroethics piece of how do we do it. I wouldn't put chips in there, but I wouldn't mind giving them a way that, like, put a QEG on their head so I operationally understand if they're under stress, fear, or something, because that would tell me what I argue for, just like we put on every one of our material systems, is human sensors. We need human sensors to monitor what the operational status is of this system we call the human. And more importantly, if they're under stress, fatigue, I want to know that, okay? The way we do it now is we sort of listen, okay? That's how I learned stress and fatigue from through the years. Actually, my problem is I probably was learning that wrong, because just because somebody's yelling and under stress, they actually might be operating in their MO and they're good, and the one that's quiet because they're an introvert is dying because they're in a situation their frontal lobes can't handle. I just don't know that. If I had a sensor, I could know that. By the way, for all of those involved with training and education, why not use a QEG that's relatively cheap? You know, it's not these big fancy, you know, wired things. There's much more economy wireless systems that can measure when do they move from novice to expert, okay? They can't measure necessarily with QEG what they learned, but you can understand the neural network and that they got it. So why not do it that way? So I think there are huge technology things that can be applied today that can enhance how we train and educate. Obviously, it'll go into the curriculum we want to put in there. So.
Final question, I'll be quick.
Sorry.
And so Think-Feel Act is interesting, but probably more important to me personally, I think the Army is how we develop learners and learning organizations. As we face very determined and capable adversaries, what we're finding is if we're not more adaptive and learn quicker than they learn, then we're going to fail regardless of the technology of the people we put into the fight. And so Malcolm Gladwell wrote a book, Outliers, and said 10,000 hours to achieve mastery. Your thoughts on how we reduce the amount of time that it takes to learn. You had 5,000 reps as an Op 4 commander. How do, or 500, whatever the number is. How do we develop a soldier, a leader, who only has to have 100 reps to take the same learning you achieved in 500 reps so that we can learn quickly as an organization, not just individuals, but as an organization. Your thoughts, please.
First of all, the 10,000 hours, okay, just understand neural networks get built in 6 weeks. So you don't need 10,000 hours. You got to, but we get, here, and you know, I don't have the exact solution here, all right? And we got lots of terms that we get at, but you got to have a baseline to start so I know how to get them there. Because I might be wasting a lot of time on stuff I don't need to waste them on. I clearly think the virtual training is going to get you your reps. It won't be perfect, okay? But it gives them, it will intentionally grow the networks that you train on. Any task you train on, multiple times, you grow the network. So you got to make sure it's the right task. We've talked about the different learning styles. Part of my challenge here is, as I've looked across this, and I have a bias to the neuroscience, primarily because it's not paid attention to like I think it should, but most of these are psychometric tools, and everybody classifies learning styles and stuff like that without really understanding what the heck's going on in the brain. It's observed behavior. That's how they get it, all right? It's like I observe how a car runs, okay, and therefore I know that I can teach somebody turn the key and push this gas pedal, and it will start, and if I push it faster, I'll go faster. That's observed behavior, all right? If I understand how the car runs, I need to open the hood and understand it's electrical circuit with a chip that's a computer process that has a fluid system that comes together at a critical point in time and achieves effect. And if I want to improve the efficiency, I got to understand how that systems works, because I can only do so much watching the car drive, all right? So we have a tendency on the Army side to stay on that side of the fence and we watch the car drive as opposed to get under the hood and say, how do I improve the performance? And to be honest, that's why I argue for the Brain 101. We are ignorant in how the brain works, but we're going to write documents on cognitive dominance without ever understanding how the brain really works. So I just throw that out to you. Obviously, it might not be accepted, but it's where it is. So I look at Gary so he can give me the evil eye, but no. I'm done. I'm sorry. I went over there. So.
Thank the speaker, please.
Let the G2 come.
General Palmer, thank you for some very compelling ideas about how we can maximize human potential. And your passion for soldiers of the future is recognized, and we greatly appreciate you being here. Here is the coveted G2 coin.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. By the way, if any of you out there have solutions to this, I run a network of, I call it Technology Capability Dating Service, but I'm looking for solutions. So if you have solutions in this area, what I want to get them is brought to the forefront so we can actually use them. So appreciate the help here. Thanks. Okay.